Well, it is with sad news that I have to report the Escort will not get to run again. I have been going all over this car trying to get it fixed, and I think it is a lost cause. I've tried all kinds of stuff, many different diagnostics, different tests, and cannot get this thing to run any longer. The original issue, the car shut off during the Derby, didn't even really get hit hard, just shut off on its own, would no longer start, engine would turn over. Had the computer tested at the parts store uptown. They said the computer was bad, they could not get a read off the computer at all, would not register any signals. So we did go to a junkyard and we swapped the computer with the another computer of the exact same kind of car, exact same engine and everything, plugged it in. Now when I turn the key, I can hear the computer turn on. It makes noise, so I know it's getting power to it. But for some reason, somewhere else in the car, the computer is not communicating to the actual dashboard for some reason. The reason the first computer died, we believe, is we had this huge rainstorm that just dumped rain for an hour right before the demolition derby. It delayed the whole derby an hour. All of our cars got rained on really bad. We even had this car tarped. But the issue, I believe, is the original computer, which is this one here, we had covered in foam and secured, and it was sitting down there in the existing battery tray that came with this car. And I believe what happened is because that is a tray and has no drain holes in it and has a lip around the tray, when it rained, I believe that battery tray got water in it and filled up with water, and it kept the water in that tray. So when we started this Escort up and had it during the Derby, this computer would have been down there in the tray with water surrounding it. So every time the car got hit, water was splashing all up on this computer, up around the connections here, and maybe there's a good chance that the water got into the actual system of the computer while power was onto the car. And I think it shorted out the computer, I think it shorted out some other sensors, I think it shorted stuff into the dash itself and killed some components. I have checked every single fuse on this car under the hood, under the dash, all along here, cannot find a single fuse that has been blown. Something that's really strange to me, I've done electrical tests on it. I am getting power to the coil pack itself. There's three wires to the coil pack there. How these four-cylinder Ford engines work, there's three wires that go to the coil pack. The coil pack has your four plugs on top of it. The center wire is your constant power to the coil pack. As long as your computer works, you have power going to this. And then when you start turning the engine over, your crankshaft position sensor will send a signal to the computer. And that computer would then send a signal to these spark pack here, and this left wire, the blue one, and this very right side wire, the pink one there, those control, one wire controls two of these, the other wire controls the other two for the spark plugs, and those will alternate back and forth, on off, on off, on off, as the engine fires and starts up, and it'll control the timing for it. Somehow the sensor, the crankshaft sensor, is not sending a signal to the computer, or the computer itself is not sending the correct signal back to the coil pack, because I cannot get that coil pack to jump signals back and forth. Like I said, it does have power to it, but it will not transmit data that the engine is trying to start. The sensor is good, the camshaft sensor is good, all the sensors are good, but for some reason there's a communication error somewhere with this car. Another weird thing that I cannot figure out is the fact that when we bought this car, it of course had its fair share of problems, but the car already had the check engine light on in the dash originally when we bought the car. No surprise, most Derby cars do. Well, that check engine light stayed on the whole time we built the car, ran it in the Derby. Well, now that I have switched computers, ever since this issue has happened, I can no longer get a check engine light to come up on the dash. And the weird thing is, yes, maybe switching computers cleared the codes, but I can actually not intentionally make the check engine light come on. I have unplugged the crankshaft sensor. I've tried unplugging the camshaft sensor. Things like that of that nature, your air sensors. When you unplug those, it should automatically send a code to your dashboard, especially on Fords. Fords are known, if the crankshaft position sensor, the CPS, if that sensor is not working, a thing that Ford does in the 90s, and I know this for sure on 90s Fords because it happened to my Thunderbird and that's how I knew what it was. If your crankshaft position sensor quits working on a 90s Ford, then when you turn your dashboard on to power, you will automatically have a check engine light stay on. when you turn your key and the engine turns over, that check engine light will stay lit up. Other vehicles, makes and models, that check engine light will turn off as you turn your key to start turning over the engine. It'll clear that light real quick, and then when the engine starts, that light will come back on if there is a current air with the engine running. But Ford's, if that check engine light stays on while the engine's turning over, it means you have a CPS problem. It's not getting a signal from it. And the weird thing is, I've unplugged that crankshaft position sensor. No data going to it, which therefore should intentionally kick on the warning light on the dash, and it will not come on. So I don't know what's going on. I just know that the original computer fried itself, and when computers fry themselves, weird things can happen, and I have a feeling it did something else to this car internally and killed some sensors or components that are important and vital to make the computer run this car. So it has me stumped. I have actually opened up this timing cover. The timing belt looks almost brand new. It is still connected perfectly fine. It turns over with the engine. The engine, you can hear it turn over. There is compression in the cylinders, just not getting a spark. I've put starting fluid down the intake to see if, you know, that'll start it, if there was an issue with fuel pressure. I also have my fuel pressure gauge. You know, when we run this car, we can dial in our fuel pressure specifically for this car, and still not getting anything attempting to start. So it's definitely a spark issue, not a fuel issue, which leads me to the electrical problems. It'd have been different, of course, if I had a blown fuse, because then I could see what that fuse was. I could follow the wiring from that fuse, see what it goes to, and it would really help me chase down the problem. But since nothing is blown, it's a complete mystery. And since the store cannot get an actual scan tool, they've plugged into these computers and they cannot get a read off of these computers. For some reason, something's not communicating to the dash where you plug in your little e-reader scan tool thing. They can't diagnose the car for me and tell me what's not working on it. So because of all this and this headache that we have gone through, I've been working on this for a couple weeks trying to figure it out, doing a lot of reading online. Sadly, the Escort will be gone. Starting after this video, me and Susan are going to start pulling all the parts off this car we want to keep. We're going to gut it as much as possible, just like the Alero. From here on out, now that I have my barn for storage, I'm going to keep a ton of parts off every single car, because many of these cars interchange, and also I need steel suspension for the future demolition derby cars that have aluminum suspension so I can interchange them. So today we will pull off anything in the interior, any cage material, outside bars, anything under the hood. I keep all my fuses, all the fluids, any good spark plug wires. We'll keep the good computer from the junkyard, because you know that turns on. Radiator's still fine. We'll take hoses from that. We will take the AC condenser. We'll pull the bumper off. Any component at all that I can keep, we will take off of this car. Last thing we will do, once the interior and under the hood has been removed, we will push it out onto my trailer. Once it's on the trailer, that's when I will pull off all of the wheels, the tires there. I'll get the struts off this car. I'll get my axles out of this car, spindles, anything I can from underneath it. And then we will say goodbye to this thing probably next week. It'll get sent off to the junkyard. So what a shame, you know. We had such a great car still. Tons of life left in this thing. The front frame hasn't really moved. Back was packing in relatively good. It really sucks, you know, when you have this happen, but this is the way of future cars with the electrical in them. You never know when they're going to bite the bullet, especially when you involve water. This is why I tell people never store a compact derby car outdoors unless you 100% have it covered from the rain, because weird stuff can happen to them when you get water involved. So, what does that mean for us as far as what is Susan going to run next? Well, since this was her car, she will be scrapping it and taking the money from this car and saving it up for a new fresh car that she gets to choose, and she will be buying her own choice of fresh vehicle. But before that, we still have the Cutlass. If you remember, back with us, we tried to start it before and we got it to fire off. I think the engine is still good. So when this Escort is now out of this garage bay, we will move the Cutlass, we'll push it out, we will push it back in here, and we're going to take all the interior from this Escort and put it inside that Cutlass. We're going to see if we can get the Cutlass to start up and drive around. If we get that Cutlass to move, then we're going to go through and rebuild it to the new set of rules that we use now. That since that car was built 2 years ago, the rules have changed. We'll get it modernized and ready to run. Hopefully Susan can still run that Cutlass before this season's over, sometime this fall. So, there you guys have it. If anybody else knows what possibly could have been the problem for this car, leave a comment below. By the time I see this comment, it'll probably be too late and the car will be scrapped, but I'm just curious if anybody else ran into issues like this and what they were doing to try to find the problem. Like I said, I've gone all over this car and have no idea left what to check. So, I will see you guys in an updated video. I'll do another video of the Escort once it's all stripped out before we say goodbye.